Okay, so today we will start a long lecture on quite an important topic, which is ecological succession in tropical forests. This is not only important, but also interesting topic, and the one which is relatively easy to talk about, because it's one of the few really complex community level issues in ecology which we reasonably well understand, and where we can to some degree predict complex community dynamics. So it's fairly satisfying, certainly by the standards of ecology, to speak about ecological succession. As you know from basic ecology, there are two kinds of succession, primary and secondary. Primary is starting from zero, from nothing alive. There is no soil with microbiome or seed bank, only parent rock or some sterile substrate. While secondary succession starts on soil. So for primary succession, this is a review of recent studies which details a typical substrate for primary succession. Volcanic eruptions provide a lot of material for primary succession. Also glaciers, especially when they are retreating, then there is a bare ground which was glaciated before. Floodplains in some cases, sand dunes, and then others, which in our case will be especially landslides. These are the natural substrates, and then there are mining sites, again a rich source of anthropogenic substrate and some other artificial bare ground. As you can see from this second graph, the studies are mostly focused on temperate zone, but of course we will ignore all of them and focus on the tropics. Let's start with a very short section on glaciers. There are basically four areas with glaciers. The Himalayas, which is bordering on subtropical, then Mount Kilimanjaro, and then number of glaciers in the Andes, and one small one in New Guinea. That's Puncak Jaya in the Indonesian part, and it's probably going to be the first one to completely disappear in relatively short time span. 1989, you can see still several ice areas which really shrunk by 2009. Another change you can see is that suddenly there is a huge hole in the ground, which is Grasberg mine, one of the largest gold and copper mines in the world, and certainly the highest positioned one, because Puncak Jaya has almost 5,000 meters. Unfortunately, the glacier is disappearing, but has been doing so for almost 100 years. So it's not only the effect of current global warming, but it certainly plays a role, and definitely we can see retreat in all other tropical glaciers. These graphs show percentage of ice loss per year, which is somewhere between 3% and 8%. So they are going to get smaller over the time. Now we can switch to more rich topic of volcanic terrains, where there is a classical ecological study following the huge explosion of Krakatau Islands, the Krakatau volcano in 1883. So there is a reconstruction of the archipelago before the explosion, and then it demolished most of the islands, and what was left is believed to be completely sterilized. So that's an excellent case for primary succession. Also, the timing was good for study, because it's already 150 years, but at the same time, it's not old enough to be ignored. In 1883, there was a lot of researchers already present in the area, and so there are surveys coming right after the explosion and all the way until the present. Also, the succession goes relatively fast because, as you can see, Krakatau is next to the Java Island, and so there is a lot of incoming seeds. This is how the islands look like now, with anak Krakatau, that means child, Krakatau's child being still active volcano. As you can see also here, smoking, and there was much more intense activity about 2 years ago. The big explosion killed about 36,000 people, almost all of them by tsunamis, which it started and which overwhelmed especially Java. This is a photograph of a chunk of coral reef which was thrown on the coast of Java as a result of tsunamis. So what do we know about Krakatau Islands? This is the anak Krakatau with some initial stages on the coast of casuarina trees. This is the recent 2018 lava flow. The anak Krakatau has been growing at the rate of about 13 centimeters a week for the last 70 years, which is quite impressive. And you can see, we will pay more attention to the succession there shortly. The other islands, which are no longer volcanically active, have developed quite a nice, relatively rich forest, which is transitioning from secondary to primary. So this is actually a very nice result after 150 years since primary succession. Krakatau is sort of tourist destination, especially when it's not volcanically active. And I was there a few years ago, and it was quite surprised by the type of the forest which developed there. But when you look at the soil layers, then you can still see the carbonized layer from the past explosion. Okay, this is the anak Krakatau, the casuarina coastal areas, and then the successional frontier where individual plants are exploiting the favorable microclimate and soil conditions in certain places. We can also see nice examples of so-called facilitation. That's the situation where one more successful plant comes first. Sometimes it's because it has nitrogen fixing abilities, nitrogen fixing bacteria, or for any other reason will become established first, and then creates a favorable condition for a different species which will join it, although it would have been unable to go first. One of these conditions are that organic matter. For instance, you see the grasses creating sort of cushion of that matter, which enriches soil and then allows other plants to come and grow. There is another example here of the facilitation. Okay, but when we look at the overall successional pathways, then there are several recorded over the years at Krakatau, also depending on the starting condition, whether it's lava flow or whether it's ash or whether it's sand on the coast. So this is also the species accumulation curve, but this is a cumulative number of species. So this is basically not recording extinctions. This is just accumulating all the species seen there from the beginning after explosion. So we are getting to about 500 total with very significant number of ferns, and then the rest are seed plants. Please can all of you mute your microphones. I hear some noise there in the background. Thank you. Okay, so when we look at these successional pathways, then let's start with lava flows. There, typically, ferns are the first stage colonizing it. Then it goes to saccharum grasses, and then to shrubs, Sertandra, Schefflera, and then Neonauclea, which is more advanced, and it can go either directly from Sertandra or sort of detour through Schefflera, and then it goes to more successionally advanced Diasoxylum, which will be followed in due time by mixed forest. So that's one possibility. From the saccharum, it can also succession can also go to casuarina, and that it can either end there, which is happening and on the coast, or can continue in the inland to Macaranga, Ficus, Terminalia mixed forest, which then goes again to Neonauclea, but also can go to Thymonius and finally Disoxylum and mixed forest. Okay, the specific succession series is on starting on the coast, on the sand, with Ipomea and Carnavalia. So these are crawlers which are colonizing beach from the coast, and then coming to grasslands, Imperata, and then either to mangrove or again to casuarina. And then finally there is a hibiscus stage which finally goes to Terminalia, and that's where it ends. This is the situation on Krakatau Islands today. So typically there is nice looking forest, but it still is typically dominated by a single species, but different species depending on local conditions, on disturbance history, elevation and the soils. So you can see most of these species were already mentioned in the successional pathways. Okay, let's look more closely on Rakata, which is one of the two islands which did not suffer the disturbance, and it's the largest one. This is the species accumulation curve, but you can see that there is a cumulative one again. This is only for Rakata, so it exceeds 300 species, but then these are the actually recorded species. So this is immigration minus extinctions. And so this is actually interesting. We have these two parameters calculated here. So over the years, so extinction went up a little bit, but then stayed more or less the same over 50 years. This is actually not very up to date. This is 1983 is the final year here. And then immigration has been declining. When you think about the theory of island biogeography with Wilson and MacArthur, this is their key graph there, where with increasing species diversity, which here corresponds to increasing timeline, we expect that immigration of new species will be declining as the ecosystem fills up with species, and that's exactly what's happening. But we also expect that extinction will be on increase, and that's not happening. So it looks like still there is enough space for new species. Once these two curves cross, then typically you get equilibrium of species diversity. So we are still not there for Rakata. What's the condition? What's the composition of the flora? You have the life forms here. You see massive representation of ferns. This is certainly not typical for well-established ecosystems in the tropics. Then about equal representation of trees and herbs and grasses. That means also lots of herbs and grasses, some shrubs. And then there is quite a large number of orchids, about half of them geophytes growing in soil and half of them epiphytes. So again, both ferns and orchids have very tiny wind dispersed seeds or spores in the case of ferns. So they are extremely good colonizers, and it shows in the composition here. A fair number of lianas and extremely small number of epiphytes other than orchids. And when it comes to the mode of distribution, you can see plants classified here into those distributed by animals, wind, which is quite dominant, and it's separated for ferns and others, which will be orchids to large large degree, and then by sea, which is also important. Humans are not really contributing much here. Okay, so this is again a reminder of Anna Krakatau, the Casuarina stage, and it looks very similar to the stage of New Guinea initial volcanic succession on the Manam Island, and it also looks quite similar to Reunion Island, which is off the coast of Madagascar. However, when you look at the natural distribution of Casuarina, you can see that it's actually invasive species on Reunion. So although these successions look quite the same, that one of them is actually a diversion of succession, which typically should go to mixed vegetation, but once the Casuarina is there, then it simply takes over the location. Okay, this is just Manam Island as it looks. In addition to Casuarina, it also has Pandanus, which you can see here as initial stage on the lava flows and ash. Okay, now we can move to Hawaii, another oceanic islands with rich volcanic history, and you can see here this is 1969 lava flow, which I took a picture of that in 2000. I have spent about half a year in Hawaii, which was quite a good location for postdoc, and so you can see that practically nothing is happening. The succession is extremely slow. You certainly don't want to have this kind of succession as your PhD dissertation topic. There is a nice study about how this is happening in the perspective of 10,000 years, and that's pretty much the time scale where something starts to be happening, and so that's the appropriate one. Of course, nobody was waiting that long. There are different lava flows which were dated on the Hawaii Islands and compared, and so you can see here the cover of main plants as it changes and on the logarithmic timeline, and when you do the more formal comparison and clustering of vegetation types, that they saw four phases, the initial one, and then there is the second one which lasts first roughly 200 years, then the next one is up to about 2000 years old, and then there are locations up to 10,000 years old in the first phase, in the third phase. And when you look at the dominance, then there are only two types of dominance. One are different species of ferns, again, and another one are two varieties of the same tree, which is Metroxylum polymorpha. This is a bit bizarre feature of Hawaii Islands, that their tropical forests, even the primary ones, are dominated by only two species, Metroxylon and Acacia coa. So Metroxylon looks like this, the developed forest, and another survey looked at how the Metroxylon as the dominant increased its height on the lava succession or ash plus lava succession. So once you have ash, it goes faster, but even then it took 100 years for the Metroxylon to reach five meters height. And while in the, for instance, we will see that in a secondary succession, it will take lowland forest about 1 year to reach that height. And you still have the Metroxylon growing in height after more than 1,000 years of succession there. Okay, this we have already shown during the first lecture. This is a reminder, this is New Britain off the coast of New Guinea. And that's showing again example where primary succession can have a very different rates, where these are locations from the same volcanic explosion. This one in the crater actually grows fairly quickly over 30 years into well-developed secondary forest. And only a few hundred meters away, there is practically no progress over the same period of time. One of the reasons is the stability of substrate. You know, you have meters of ash here, which just gets eroded, moved by wind, and that's very hard for plants. While here, this is on the left, this is more stable substrate. Some of the plants are coping by crawling over the surface, as you can see here, and that's the way they can colonize even unstable substrate. Okay, now another sort of bizarre situation in New Guinea. It's a Lang Island, which used to be again a huge volcano, and now has a large freshwater lake, 170 meters deep, in the middle, and that's collapsed caldera after a huge explosion. Island is still active, and again in the lake there is actually emerging a small volcanically active island, Motmot. But unlike with Krakatau, where we know about the explosion, this huge explosion of the past is dated to sometime between 1650 and 1670. And it only was witnessed by local people, not by European explorers at the time, but it's dated based on the geological evidence, and it looks like it was much bigger explosion than Krakatau, where it ejected about 10 cubic kilometers of ash into the air, and so it's one of the largest recorded explosions in the last 500 years. And there were no witnesses from the European side, although they came close, because the island was actually first recorded, mapped, and named by William Dampier, who was a former pirate and then English explorer with lots of amazing journeys, one of them following the northern coast of New Guinea and mapping all the islands here. So he came 1699, so fairly close after the explosion, 40 years probably, and this is his drawing of the profile of the island compared to the current situation. So it's very clear that he came after the explosion with his ship, which you can see here. So however, that is an interesting situation, because in New Guinea, missionaries, anthropologists noted that there is a large number of very similar indigenous folk tales, which were sort of orally transmitted and which were describing some ancient period of time where suddenly sun disappeared and ash was falling from the sky and so on. And finally they collected about 97, at least 97 these legends, and they were from at least 15 languages. They talked about the time of darkness typically, and when you map them, you can see that they are actually corresponding very nicely with the impact area of the Lang Island explosion. In a red area, that's the boundary of at least 15 centimeter ash fall, and the blue area is where this kind of ash fall was from Long Island, was the latest, the most recent volcanic explosion of that size. And so it's reasonable to assume that these tales are typically speaking about the Long Island. And the geologist Richard Blanc collected all the information, and there is direct or indirect description of how much ash was falling. And so when you compare it with the models of what was the expected ash fall, and of course that ash is still visible as a layer in the geological record, so you can measure it. And so there is actually a fair amount of consistency between different tales, including the two which were close to the Long Island. And so there they had a large reported as well as expected ash fall. So there was a pretty clear evidence, except for five different tales or six different tales, which where the imagination really ran wild, and they reported completely impossible layers of ash falling on them. Also, some of the tales were actually looking at this event as beneficial. Not much damage, but then gardens started growing very well. And these are actually clustered. That's the green ones. They are clustered in the highlands, where you can expect that marginal ash fall will fertilize the land, not do much damage. While negative ones, the orange ones, were the damage was likely. So the conclusion from this is interesting, that the orally past legends can be pretty accurate for 350 years without any written record. So that's actually impressive, except for one issue, and that is the timing of the event. These legends typically time it by generations, you know, grandfather of my own grandfather, whatever. And when you look at this, then these are the timings of the event based on the folk tales, and they are widely off the actual eruption. And that is because they simply underestimate the timing. They are not able to keep adding generations after generation as the folktale is passed. It usually happens three generations to the past, and that's it. So timing is hopeless. Now we go to another primary or also secondary forest succession, and that's on the landslides. This is the aftermath of a huge earthquake which happened in Papua New Guinea in 2018 in the highlands. It was magnitude 7.5, and we have magnitude 6 is nothing to write home about. That's pretty much routine here, I would say once a year, but 7.5 is actually a huge one. I was actually there in the highlands, not very far from the epicenter, and it was quite unusual. And you can see that the same you can read from the landscape, where these are all landslides triggered by this huge earthquake. And so you can already see that this type of landslide is a very important factor for the dynamics of rainforests. This is actually nothing new. Already in 1979, there was a paper in Science, which made it to also the title page. I couldn't find any better representation of the title page, because, you know, that's time before internet. And that paper analyzed New Guinea and Panama, and the authors concluded that in New Guinea, earthquake-caused landslides are as important as tree falls for the disturbance regime. There are a few more pictures of New Guinea. Earthquakes, earthquake-triggered landslides. So the earthquakes trigger landslides of different size and also different loss of soil. So then there can be either primary or secondary or both succession series. This is example from Puerto Rico of a smaller landslide, and that paper makes an important distinction that when you look at the succession following on landslide, then there are two factors. One, whether the landslide soil is unstable or stable. This is the same problem as we mentioned with volcanic ash. If it's unstable, it definitely slows down the succession. And then how the soil looks like, if it's only surface landslide with still good soil on top, or whether it goes deeper. So either there is a newly exposed mineral soil, or there is still some residual topsoil left, and that leads to sort of a secondary type succession, which can be pretty fast, especially on stable on stable surface. So you have pioneer shrubs and trees within 1 year since the landslide, while it can take 10 years on unstable and deep landslide, it can take 10 years to get even first colonizers there. Now, as you can expect, most of the landslides are small. This is the size distribution, again, from Puerto Rico, the size distribution of landslides. So the largest number was somewhere between 200 and 400 square meters. So that's sort of typical size of a canopy gap. But then there can be few huge ones. And when you look at what land area is involved, then actually the few huge ones represent 40% of entire area. So they are pretty important. And this is an example of a landslide in Sarawaget Mountains in Papua New Guinea, illustrating that the deep central section basically has barely any succession, while on the sides where presumably there was some soil left, you can already quite successful succession going on. This is again Sarawaget Mountains. These are very geologically young, only 3 million years old mountain ranges, which are actually still growing very fast, 4 millimeters a year in height. And so this kind of steep, rugged terrain is especially vulnerable to the landslides. And what you can see here, there is no human damage, human disturbance. This is all natural landslides over the years, and they expose soil for secondary succession here mostly, and it's actually being invaded by Piper aduncum, which is a South American invasive plant. And you can see it here, for instance, but then it's everywhere and it only goes to disturbed places. So it's a nice indicator of recent disturbance. And so when you color all the Piper aduncum, you get this kind of landscape. So you can see how hugely important can landslide dynamics be for this steep terrain. Not only for the steep terrain, we have the 50-hectare forest plot in lowland forest in Wanang, which is basically flat on large scale, but hilly. And although there is only 90 meters elevation of difference between lowest and highest point in this plot, still there is quite intense landslide dynamics. My colleague Tim Whitfeld did a study there with our New Guinea collaborators, and they found 8 new landslides over the 4 months of observation with 1600 square meters. That translates to about 4,800 meters of landslides within 50 hectares, which is 1% of the area every year. So if we consider landslides to be closed, the canopy closed by succession over 20 years, which, is pretty fast, then it still means that there is at least 20% of the entire area recently impacted by landslide and having effect on vegetation. That actually is the case in the plot where we estimated the age of vegetation. And so you can see that there is a lot of mosaic with light squares. This is 20 times 20 meter squares. And when you summarize that, then you can see this is the age distribution of vegetation, where there is actually only about 60% of vegetation which is older than 50 years. And that's a generally primary undisturbed forest, but very dynamic one. This is how a landslide in that 50 hectare plot can look like. Okay, now we are moving to secondary succession, and we will start with forest regeneration in canopy gaps. These gaps are mostly caused by tree falls. They can also be caused by wind, and you can have also some large-scale disturbances, already mentioned landslides, but also there can be some local fires, for instance. when we talk about the tree gaps, that these can be still of very different sizes. There can be really small ones where you have a tree which dies standing, as you can see here, for instance. And so the branches are, the dead branches are falling down and sort of disturbing vegetation. So this is very limited and canopy gap. But you can also have really large ones where not only there is a fall of large tree, but oftentimes the trees are tied down together with lianas, and so fall of a big tree means that there is a domino effect, and a large number of trees is falling down together. So now looking at the sizes of these canopy gaps. Okay, there is a study looking at the satellite photos and reading the canopy gaps in the Amazon. And as you can expect, there is a huge number of gaps which are involving one or very few trees. And then the increasing size of disturbance, of course, has a decreasing frequency, going all the way to extremes, which can actually include 1,000 or more than 1,000 trees. But that's diminishing frequency. So there is a power law, which is followed by these the size distribution. And from the entire study, there was one simple, a single huge event, including more than 100,000 trees, and that was caused by wind. And here you can see it. And this kind of big disturbances bigger than 5 hectares are very rare. So they are actually less important than you would expect. They measured their frequency as coming less than once every 20,000 years. While of course, tree gaps are coming much more frequently from single falls of trees or a few trees. How frequently is important question. Again, there is a measurement across the Amazon, and you can see on the scale that typically it's somewhere between 0.5 and 1%. So overall, the new gaps form at about 1% rate in the Amazon, although there are some extremes exceeding 2%. 1% actually is a quite dynamic forest again, because that means a typical lifespan of a big tree to be 100 years. And because these gaps are typically caused by tree falls. There is, as you can expect, there is a correlation between the rate of formation of gaps and tree mortality, but it's not one-to-one relationship. There is actually, for instance, here, again from Amazon, 1% of gap creation corresponds to roughly 2% tree mortality. So that means that some trees die not opening a gap. And now, why the gaps are so important? Of course, that's all about light. Yeah, gap basically removes existing competitors, existing plants, or at least most of them, and opens the light conditions, which is very important because there is very little light in the understory, typically at about 1% of the full sunlight. This is the graph showing that. And then these are some measurements from even secondary forest. This is a 9-old-year forest, and you can again see very steep curve of decreasing relatively light intensity with height from the ground. So once the canopy is closed, then if you stayed under the canopy, then and you are a plant, then you are certainly in trouble. And that of course goes also for the older secondary forest shown here. Again, here there are. This is the sunlight over the time from 6 in the morning to 6 in the evening, which is sunrise and sundown on equator. And you can see that the smaller gaps are quite logically less illuminated than large gaps or even big clearings. And that's simply because the small gaps are shaded by trees from the side. So that's also important, as we will see, for succession. Typically, basically, gaps are extremely attractive piece of real estate. Plants are really struggling to colonize them because there are ideal conditions. That's why we have specialized plants which are seeking these gaps, which can colonize them quickly. And once they are there, then there is a very intense race of who will grow fastest, because once you get into closing the canopy, then either you are in or you are out. So it's very intense competition. This is a reminder from the previous lecture that the ecological succession is based on the trade-off between this ability of growing very fast and ability to survive in low light conditions. And so we have this trade-off, which is expressed by these lines. So that means there is a correlation between mortality and growth rate. And we have this group of specialized pioneer trees, which have extremely high growth, and that means very, very high mortality in the shade. And these are the colonizers of gaps. So this is basically a simple distinction between, basically it's a one continuum, it's a fast, slow continuum in plant life history strategies. Okay, as usual, ecologists try to complicate things. And so this is ordination of life history traits for 625 plant species across the global floras and different growth forms. And it shows that in addition to this fast, slow dimension, which is expressed along the first PCA axis with variables like growth rate, which is number 4 here, and generation time. So you have either fast growing, short living plants, or you have slow growing, long living ones. There are also survivorship curve and the age of sexual maturity. Again, you can have not only long living, but also late reproducing plants surviving in shade. So that's a typical fast, slow continuum. But then they recovered also second independent dimension, which was different reproductive strategies. So you can have either slow or fast breeders. Okay, when it comes to ecological theory, then sort of continuation of this work was published in last 3 years in 2 papers, and they again recovered or sort of replicated the fast slow gradient, which is here on the x-axis again. And so if we want to classify the strategies into distinct model, distinct modes, distinct categories, then we can say we have fast species, which are pioneers, and then we have slow ones, which are surviving in shade, and then we have some intermediate ones. Okay, but then they actually look at demographic characteristics of the species. And they were looking at recruitment. So that means, you know, how fast you are producing seeds and seedlings which recruit from them. And then they were looking at survival in different layers of the forest. That's 1, 2, 3, 4. That's survival from the canopy, which is 1, all the way to down in understory, and growth again. Growth in these different layers. And so that's the growth survival trade-off. But then they were also looking at the second axis, which was not only reproduction, but also body size, basically what was your stature. And so there are basically classical fast, intermediate, and slow growers. And then there are what they call long-lived pioneers. that's the green spot, which means that basically they are surviving they are surviving good on the in the canopy, so that's survival number one. They are not reproducing very fast, and then there are the opposite spectrum, which is what they call short-lived breeders. And so these are small plants, which typically are in the understory, and they have poor growth, low survival, low small body size, but produce large number of offspring. So these are typically sort of understory shrubs, which are sort of trying to survive in bad conditions and reproduce. While long-lived pioneers are big trees, which are surviving in the canopy. So if you classify based on these parameters trees to these five categories, that's what they did in Barro Colorado Island again for 282 species, because they have enough data there on their survival and reproduction and body size. And so this is the result. Yeah, these are different categories of the trees, and there are some examples. So this slow shade survivor is Trichilia tuberculata. We already mentioned it, the most common understory shrub. Cecropia is the pioneer species, fast breeder. Lueha simani is also pioneer, but it's growing longer and to bigger size. So that's a long-lived pioneer. And then short-lived breeder is Psychotria, that's understory shrub. And then intermediate is intermediate Cupania cinerea. So when we classify the trees into these strategies, then this is the result. So in terms of individuals and species for Barro Colorado, so again, the colors correspond. So slow shade survivors are most common one in terms of individuals, but then the fast pioneer species are also important, and even more so in terms of species. This is the modeling of the succession based on these five groups. So you have first goes pioneers, but they fade out very quickly, and they are replaced by the long-lived pioneers. And then all the time the pioneers are there blocking the canopy. Then the slow shade survivors are on increase and finally replace them. While the intermediate and the short-lived breeders are sort of marginal importance throughout the succession. So when we look at these new fancy schemes and try to reconcile them with more traditional life strategies for succession, this is such an example. The old classification says that there are trees germinating under the closed canopy, and they are either able to withstand and grow all the way to canopy in poor light conditions. So that's slow and also short-lived breeders, or they are waiting in the understory for a canopy opening, and then they will grow fast to reach the canopy. So that will be again some of the slow species, but also intermediate ones. And then for the pioneers, there was actually a scheme which already anticipated this distinction between short lifespan and small species and a long-lived large species, which are now also called long-lived pioneers. This is an example of such long-lived pioneer. This is succession from Solomon Islands, where there was some kind of disturbance. Pioneers came in, and then finally the canopy was closed by Campnosperma brevi petiolatum, which is long-lived pioneer. So that forest can persist long time until these trees die, and then the slow shade tolerant species will take over. Okay, so these are the general life histories, but then there has been also attempt to classify plants based on the ecophysiology of their leaves. And that's also very relevant to succession, because there is a very strong gradient in how the leaves are constructed and how they photosynthesize and how they behave. And so this is paper led by Joe Wright, and their team analyzed again several hundred of species and their leaf characteristics. And they actually found that a large, fairly large number of important parameters can be ordered into one-dimensional sequence. So they are basically either positively or negatively correlated, but along the one sort of gradient. And so they call it leaf economic spectrum. It's one-dimensional trend. And so let's look at it. First, what characteristics we have? There are six of them. Leaf mass per area. That's basically how thick and solidly built is the leaf. It's a biomass per square centimeter of the leaf. Sometimes it's expressed the opposite way as a specific leaf area. So that means number of square centimeters per 1 gram of biomass. It's pretty much the same thing, only differently expressed. Then we have photosynthetic capacity. That's the photosynthesis under optimum light. And so that determines growth rate under good conditions. Okay, then we have leaf nitrogen, indicates metabolic activity, especially protein production. Phosphorus content, again, metabolic activity and growth. It's needed for nucleic acid production. Then we have dark respiration rate. That's basically, again, that's the rate of plants expending energy, and that has to be compensated by photosynthesis during the day. And finally, leaf lifespan. If you invest into leaf, then how long it will last, whether it's sort of permanent investment or very temporary one. So these are important characteristics, and now how they are correlated. You can see this three-dimensional graphs where on the x-axis you always have leaf mass area, and then for instance, when you look at correlation with nitrogen content, then the scale here is from the highest values to the lowest at the back. And so you can see that the higher leaf mass area, the lower nitrogen. So you have either thin, light leaves with lots of nitrogen, or you have thick, heavy leaves with low percentage of nitrogen, okay? When you see at when you look at again leaf mass area and photosynthesis, then that's the shade here at the back, and so there is clearly a negative negative correlation. So again, thin, not well built leaves have actually high photosynthetic capacity as opposed to heavy leaves, and that corresponds to nitrogen. That corresponds to nitrogen correlation. So that, you know, the more nitrogen, the more photosynthetic activity and more metabolic activity. Nitrogen goes together with phosphorus. So you can see it here. So with phosphorus and nitrogen positively correlated, and then here you have leaf lifespan, and again the light leaves with small leaf mass area are short living, as you can expect. They are not built very well. They are not built to last. While heavy leaves have long lifespan, and then also respiration goes together with photosynthesis. So when we summarize all this, then this is the leaf economic spectrum, which goes from leaves which are heavily built, long living, with low metabolic activity, low photosynthesis, low respiration, low nitrogen, and low phosphorus. These are basically slow. When you invest into them, you get slow return on investment, slow metabolism. Okay, and then it transitions to all the opposites of these characteristics, to quick leaves, which are typical for early successional pioneers, which are built very small use of biomass to capture large area. That means they can't last for very long. They have short lifespan and they have very intense metabolism because they are maximizing the growth of the whole plant. So this is again a nice gradient between shade tolerant and pioneer species, which is not based on any kind of mortality or other demographics, but it's based on ecophysiology and morphology of leaves. But of course, there is a connection with ecophysiology through the photosynthesis. So I will briefly explain how it works. This is the relationship between the assimilation between the photosynthesis and the light intensity. So if there is no light, then plant is respirating, not photosynthesizing. And so that baseline respiration is shown here at the start of the curve. And so that's basically how demanding energetically is the plant. And therefore, when the light starts increasing, the photosynthesis starts to compensate the respiration until the light compensation point, which is basically balanced, energetically balanced state. And that's the minimum light where the plant can long-term survive. And how high is this light compensation point will define whether we are dealing with a shade tolerant species or not. Okay. And then there is further increase to positive values with photosynthesis, but it's not endless, of course. After the photosynthetic apparatus is coming saturated, then it slows down and finally reaches an asymptote, which is light saturation point. And that's where the photosynthetic system is running at full speed. And so any further increase in light makes no difference. And again, that defines how fast the plant can grow. And so pioneer species have light saturation point, but that also means they have light, they have high light compensation point. You can't have photosynthetic apparatus, which will have both favorable low light compensation point and favorably high light saturation point. This is simply not possible. So we have these two types of plants, one which is performing better at low light, but then saturates quickly and so can grow fast. And then we have sun adapted plants, which is terrible at low light, but then has a very long way to go with increasing light. So finally, it assimilates four times as fast as the shade plant here. These are just examples of different photosynthetic rates with increasing light. Ochroma, which is a typical pioneer species called balsa, it's balsa wood, has again photosynthesis several times higher than gap-dependent slower species and even lower for the shade-tolerant species, which again have four times slower photosynthesis than ochroma. And then corresponding empirical values for survival rate for pioneer versus primary forest seedlings. Okay, so when we summarize, again, I will still go primarily for this very simple dichotomy between pioneer and shade tolerant species. And in addition to features we already discussed, there are some other ecological correlates. Some of them are sort of logically following from what we already said. For instance, a specific wood gravity, which is basically wood density. Again, if the pioneer plant is trying to maximize the growth, then obviously, it can't build very heavy wood. It will not invest into wood. So it will have a low density wood. And that means also low short lifespan because it will break or decay very fast. There are some things which we already mentioned and some which we will skip. But then there is leaf toughness. Again, low in pioneers, high in shade tolerant. We mentioned leaf lifespan, And then there is also herbivore resistance. The pioneer plants are, again, by trying to maximize growth, they are not really investing heavily into defense from herbivores. And at the same time, because of the high nitrogen content, they are very attractive to herbivores. And so they typically suffer high herbivory. This is typical, this is Makaranga species, and it's typical pioneer species, how it looks like in the field. But the reason why they are tolerating that is that herbivores are not their main problem. Herbivores are second-rate enemies. The main problem are other plants which are trying to shade them. And so if they are eaten like that, it's still okay as long as they can top other plants. If they have perfectly clean leaves, but they are overshadowed by other plants, then they are in bigger troubles. Also, you can quickly recognize pioneer plants simply by having these soft, large, short-living leaves, as opposed to shade tolerant, which are much more tough. Okay, so now what these plants are doing on community level, how the canopy gap dynamics look like. You can see again a canopy gap here, and what happens is that, okay, if we have a tree fall, there is a canopy opening, and then there are some existing seedlings and saplings which survive the tree fall, and then there are immediately also new seedlings growing from the seed bank, and then there is a very short living but very intense race to make it to the canopy and closed canopy, even at a low height. Yeah, the first closure of canopy can be 1 or 2 meters high, but it's extremely important because as you see on the third picture, once you close the canopy, that's pretty much it. There will be no new entrance into the competition. It will only be now a competition between those who are in the canopy, while those in the understory will not be able to penetrate the canopy. They will either die, or if they are shade tolerant, they will have to wait for their opportunity in the future. And then once the canopy is closed, then the plants keep growing. So the whole canopy is raising up at height, but also the plants are self-thinning. So that means some of them die simply because they can't fit physically when other plants are growing. And so you have a closed canopy of pioneer species, but they are short-living, they can't regenerate in their own shade, and so then they will die, which will open light conditions, and those saplings waiting there, either long-lived pioneers or shade-tolerant species, will race to the top and close the canopy, and the whole cycle is finished. This is one of more extreme examples of such a closed canopy. This is a drawing of Musanga Secropoides dominated forest. The Musanga is here, which sort of single species closed canopy like that. And that's the pioneer stage. When it dies, then the waiting species will create primary forest, which in the same location in Congo looks like this one. Okay, so now when we are looking at what exactly is happening in gaps, then let's start with seeds. There is an important distinction between seeds which are surviving in soil bank and seeds which have to germinate rapidly. And that dichotomy corresponds to pioneer species versus shade tolerant. Pioneer species, not 100%, but typically survive in soil bank and have a small, often wind dispersed seeds, while you can see some of the primary forest seeds and fruits selection here. They are typically larger seeds with stored nutrients, and these are not surviving in the soil bank. They typically germinate and survive long term as seedlings or saplings. So, for instance, so when you look at soil bank, then the pioneer species are widely dispersed over the landscape. So they are also entering soil bank in primary forest vegetation. So when you take soil from inside of primary forest, where there are no pioneer species nearby, you will still grow pioneer species from that soil, same as when you take it from the secondary forest. I have been teaching that for a long time. Finally, this year we tried it here in Papua New Guinea, and indeed you have these examples from the primary and secondary mountain forest, and then this is the soil and first plants growing. These are basically early successional species, and you can't basically tell by species composition which one is from secondary soil and which one is from primary, although the mature forests there look completely different with basically zero species overlap. So these secondary species are everywhere in the soil. So that's why they are ready to germinate once there is suddenly opening of the canopy in the primary forest. This is a study which illustrates similar point. This is the succession in tropical Australia, and they were looking at young, intermediate, secondary, old secondary, and primary forest, and they were looking at three different levels: at seed bank, at understory plants, and canopy plants. And this is the ordination based on species composition. And what is important here is that when you look at the seed bank, it clusters together no matter what is the forest type. Yeah, the dark one is mature forest and light one is the young secondary. They basically are together. This is different from the secondary forest and from the primary forest, which are separated, and then they have the understory and canopy together. So it's only seed bank which is mixed. And indeed you have these species which are only in the secondary seed bank. They are secondary species which are in the seed bank, primary species and shared ones. And so you can see that the shared and secondary is large proportion, unlike with the actual vegetation. Okay, now for the seed bank, this is example of succession with three typical pioneer species, Trichospermum, Cecropia, and Trema. What they are doing in 25 years of secondary succession, you can see that the dashed line is production of seeds. They have different dynamics. Trema is producing seeds in extremely early few years, and then basically goes down to zero. So that means it will establish the seed bank, and that seed bank will persist more or less constantly for 20 years. Cecropia has different dynamics. It will peak seed production at about 10 to 15 years of age of succession. And that means that the seed bank is building over the time in soil. The same goes for Trichospermum. So you know, the production of seed bank basically accumulates because seeds are viable and surviving several years. Now, the question is how the seeds know that there is a gap opening above them when they are in the soil, because if a pioneer species makes a mistake and germinates under the closed canopy, then it will die. So it's important they know. Okay, there are two factors. One is sort of mundane and one is pretty cool. The mundane factor is heat. When there is direct sunlight, then the soil heats more than in the understory, and the seeds will start germinating. Another one is the wavelength of the visible light. If the seeds are shallow enough in the soil, when you look at the spectrum in the forest clearing and understory, you can see a very clear drop between 600 and 700 nanometers. That's the photosynthetically active light, and so that's filtered by vegetation. So there is very little in the understory, reaching understory. But once there is a forest clearing, suddenly that radiation rapidly improves, and that can be detected by seeds of pioneer plants. So this is a laboratory experiment exposing seeds of Cecropia and Piper auritum to different wavelengths, and the germination indeed responded to between 600 and 700 nanometers. Now, the pioneer species, when they start growing, they still have to compete with existing shade-tolerant seedlings, because, as we said, shade-tolerant species are surviving as seedlings and saplings in the forest understory. So pioneer trees might be fast growers, but they have a handicap. When the canopy gap opens, then there are already surviving shade-tolerant species. But the pioneers have to grow all the way from seed. And so indeed they can win, because they can grow many times faster, but only in the large gaps where the shade, the sun conditions are very good. But in the small gaps, this is a study showing individual species, which are either a primary shade tolerant species or pioneer, which are in red. And what are the growing species, what are the height of plants after 1 year of growth in gaps of different sizes. And in this particular case, you can see that in the small gaps until about 200 square meters, it's the shade tolerant species which are winning. They don't grow very high, very, very tall, but they are better than anything else. And it's only in the bigger gaps where the pioneers are consistently winning. And so this is important for the forest dynamics. So when you have a forest disturbance, depending on the size of the disturbance, you can get from the primary forest simply back to primary forest again. There is no succession. The existing shade tolerant seedling saplings will simply grow, reach the canopy, mature, and the forest will cycle in the same species composition. Or if it's bigger disturbance, it will go to all the way back to pioneer species and then go through the succession. Now, these seedlings and saplings of shade tolerant trees, they are actually quite interesting in the forest, because they tend to be very long living. So, you know, if you are walking through the understory of tropical forest, you know, you tend to sort of assume that all these little seedlings and saplings are new, are recent, and then they will either die or will grow and make it to the canopy. That actually happens rarely. Typical fate is that they are sort of endlessly waiting there in sort of limbo, in a very low metabolic state, and waiting for their opportunity to get a bit back, a bit better light and grow to the canopy. So again, Barro Colorado, there is a good estimate of the medium age of plants when they reach 1 centimeter DBH. The thickness of stem 1 centimeter. So this is the frequency of different species. What is the medium age in years when the plant reaches 1 centimeter? And when you go across all the species, then typically, in order to reach 1 centimeter stem, you are there for 16.6 years. And some of the species take 45, 50, 60, in extreme case, 85 years to reach 1 centimeter thickness. And other study, this time from Malaysia, looked at seedlings. And so that means something which is below 20 centimeters height. And what percentage of them are more than 10 years old? And you can see that there is quite a variation, but typically, it's at least half of the seedlings are still there after 10 years, not basically going anywhere. So when you go through the understory, you are actually walking through fairly ancient vegetation there. This is another example from Australia, where these are individual cohorts of chrysophyllum tree and how long they are surviving as seedlings. And you can see that after 30 years, there is still 5% of the recruits which are still in the seedling stage. Again, what the seedlings are doing, this is back to the study in Dipterocarp forest in Borneo, and you can see that here, this is what the individual seedlings for different trees were doing in 2 years of observation. Black is that they died, then orange is that they actually diminished in size, you know, losing leaves, losing branches. Blue is that they did nothing, they basically were the same, and only violet is moderate growth, and then fast growth is green. So you can see that most of the seedlings were basically going nowhere, either dying or shrinking or being the same. And when they looked the next 2 years at this minority of fast growing seedlings, again, they saw that it's not like they continue to fast grow further and further. No, majority of them after 2 years of fast growth fell back again to a slow growth or steady state. And only few continued fast growth, and very few red ones transitioned to saplings. So again, you know, really picture of sort of stasis of very little change and basically waiting for opportunity. On the contrary, once pioneer species start growing, they can grow extremely fast. It's again, for somebody from temperate zone, it continues to amaze. This is an example of a Homalanthus novogvineensis pioneer tree, which we planted as a 1.5 meter sapling. And in 4 years, it grew into very solid tree and then promptly fell on our house. Again, we did not anticipate how that tree will grow. The same Musanga secropoides takes 5 years to reach 18 meters height. Some others with comparison with primary forest species, which are growing even in good conditions much slower. Again, when we are looking at what pioneer species, again, Trema, Cecropia, and Trichospermum from the study we already mentioned are doing, then one point to illustrate here is that although the succession has certain rules and principles, then the actual composition of individual locations can be very unpredictable because it depends on random factors such as the supply of seeds, what is in the seed bank, what are the individual light conditions in different parts. So this is, for instance, the study of number of abundant fields in Mexico when there is a secondary succession. And these are nice averages of population density over number of years, over 14 years, and for Trema, Cecropia, and Trichospermum. But then on the right side, you see trajectories for individual sites. And you can see that there is a huge variation. Yeah, so these nice means are actually means which are coming from very variable and predictable succession. Now, further what the trees are doing there, when you look at the early successional pioneers, then these are the principles there. The growth of biomass, that means the increments of biomass, is very fast at the beginning, but then diminishes with increasing succession, with continuing succession very fast. Mortality starts growing fast. And so when you combine these two, then you will get an early peak in biomass and going down in the abundance. And then there is actually an opposite dynamics of the late successional species. So when we actually look at examples, this is the increase in individuals. which is basically growth, population growth rate R, and it's quite fast at the very beginning for all the pioneers, extremely fast for Trema, but it goes down very quickly and then goes to negative values, which means mortality is exceeding the number of recruits. When you look at the DBH of individual trees, how it changes, of course, the mean DBH is growing over time, but you can see that the small classes are disappearing. There are basically no small classes. That means the lack of recruitment in the later years, which corresponds to this growth rate. So you have, again, lots of trees of different sizes at the beginning, and then some of them make it to the canopy, close it, and then they grow further, but then there are no new recruits of small sizes under them. Okay, now, pioneer trees are a very distinct category, and there are not many of them. Yeah, you can actually master tropical pioneer trees relatively well in terms of taxonomy. There is a table of common pioneer trees across different continents. This is something which, of course, you can't even attempt to do for late successional trees. So we are not going to go into details here, but for the neotropics, we can highlight there are some piper species. There are approximately 100 species of Cecropia, which we have seen a number of times. We have Trema as fast growing, which is interesting because it exists on all three continents, also in Africa and the Southeast Asia, New Guinea, Australia region. And then we have Ochroma, which we have seen, that's a balsa wood. And then with Larch, which will be basically the category of large long-living pioneers. We have Ceiba pentandra, which is sort of more famous. When we go to Africa, okay, some of the ficus and Philanthus. Then we have Trema again, and Makaranga, but not too many species. Musanga cecropoides, very, very common. Spatorea campanulata, which is famous by becoming invasive species in other regions. And again, Ceiba pentandra, interestingly, also in Africa. And some Terminalia, okay? And then when we go to Southeast Asia, we have a very prominent Makaranga, more than 100 species. So that's a real principal pioneer genus. And then we have Malotus species, Pipturus, Trichospermum, Trema again, and then some Acacias. And that's pretty much it, Eucalyptus, one Eucalyptus and Alpisia. Okay, so these are some examples. We mentioned Trema, looks like this. Balsa wood, family Bombaceae, typical Makaranga, and then typical Cecropia. Okay, now, as I said, individual plants, pioneer plants can grow very fast. That also applies to entire vegetation. This is lowland New Guinea, where it starts from freshly cut primary forest, so basically bare ground, and the spontaneous selection succession makes it already to this size after 2.5 years. And then this sort of relatively decent, although secondary forest, which is 15 meters tall, it's after less than 6 years. Okay, now some of the differences between primary and secondary forests. Again, they are based on samples of 1 hectare of lowland forest in New Guinea. This is how it looks like, and these are the trees with 5 centimeters diameter and above. So you can see that actually when you look at the trees only, then the tree density is not terribly different. When you look at the species composition on genus level, I think I already showed that before, you see higher diversity of genera and a low dominance of any genus in the primary forest compared to secondary. And here you have indeed Makaranga, as these are abundance of trees, not species. And so the most trees are from Makaranga, and then we have also Trichospermum and Ficus. Now some structural features. This is the leaf biomass in kilograms per hectare for low understory plants, which are below 130 centimeters, that's yellow. Then higher plants, but below 5 centimeters DBH, and then green ones are plants which have 5 centimeter DBH, and so this is the foliage on them. So in this case, you can see that, as expected, there is higher foliage biomass of primary forest and then secondary, and the secondary has much more dense understory. So that's the brown and yellow area combined, and primary forest has biomass of leaves concentrated in the canopy. So secondary forest has only 73% of primary forest leaf area. And at the same time, there is an even bigger difference in basal area. So that means cross-section of the individual trees, but not in the tree density. As we have seen, that the number of trees is pretty much the same, about 1100 to 1200 per hectare when we measure we consider 5 centimeters DBH and higher. But there are bigger trees in primary forest. There is no mystery about it. So these are the structural features between the primary and secondary forest. There are some more here. Leaf biomass, we have already mentioned that. Okay, foliar nitrogen, as you can expect from all the discussions we had, it's higher concentration in secondary forest than primary. Specific leaf area, again, bigger than in primary forest, which means that leaf mass will be in opposite direction. And then we also said that secondary forests are less defended from herbivores. And indeed, there was a very significant difference in herbivorous caterpillars on secondary forest leaves than on primary when expressed per tree. Of course, we can also look at per caterpillar per kilogram of the foliage. Again, a higher intensity in secondary forest. So for the secondary succession, this is a study from lowland New Guinea forest, where not really surprisingly, we can see that there is a progression from low diversity secondary forest to high diversity primary forest, and it works on the level of species, families, and genera as well. Basically very little progression from young secondary to old secondary, because that process is simply working with the same individual plants, let alone species, which are just growing in size and therefore self-thinning. So some of them will be outcompeted, some of them stay, but there will be very little new arrivals during that transition from young to old secondary. More interestingly, we can look at phylogenetical diversity of the communities, not only counting species or genera or families, but looking how the selection of the communities is done from the regional species pools, which of course have certain phylogenetical relationships. And so when we look at how we assemble a community from the regional species pool, there are two extreme ways to do it. On the left side, you can see highly clustered situation where the species in a secondary forest community are recruited from one single lineage. So that means they are highly phylogenetically related. And so they are phylogenetically clustered. it's non-random selection towards higher relationships, higher relatedness of species. And then the opposite situation is shown in the another graph where the community is assembled non-randomly from a much higher diversity of lineages than we would expect if we just select them randomly. And the same goes for the primary forest community. So we can look at what is the real situation, again, coming to the same data set on New Guinea lowland communities. We can look at the pairwise distance between all species in the community and compare it to what will be the situation with a random selection of the same number of species for that community. And we will see that in this case, the early secondary and to a lesser degree also late secondary vegetation was clustered, while primary vegetation was over dispersed. So that means that there are certain plant lineages which are especially recruiting pioneer species, and that is not the case for primary forest vegetation. This is a general trend. These are other communities, Mexico, Costa Rica, Brazil, and all of them have early succession clustered and the late succession over dispersed. So indeed there are lineages of plants which especially recruit pioneer species. Regarding other trends in the community, this is Costa Rica lowland succession, individual trajectories and the average. These are trajectories in 10 times 10 meter quadrats for plants above 5 centimeter DBH. And we can see 40 years of secondary succession and then the old growth or primary forest. Not surprisingly, there is an increase in biomass over the time, and that is, however, generated by diminishing rate of growth, biomass growth. So biomass is growing all the time. We are in positive numbers, but the rate of growth is slowing down over the succession, and that is, as we see in this bottom graphs, that is due to both decreasing rate of new biomass as well as increasing rate of mortality. Further, we have also increasing species richness, more or less, and then even much more steady trend of increasing phylogenetic diversity, which again demonstrates the transition from clustered pioneer species from few lineages to over dispersed one in the primary forest. Now, this is another data set from Congo, succession after shifting agriculture, which demonstrates a few trends. One is the change in species composition, and another we will be looking at changes in species diversity and also functional diversity and carbon content. So when we look at this is the ordination based on species composition for successional forests starting from early succession in after 5 years all the way to 60 years and then again old growth. We can see there is a transition between secondary forests up to 20 years old. Then unfortunately there is a gap in the data. We jump to 60 years, which is already clustering with the old growth. The mechanism for this change is illustrated here, where for these successional stages, we see that there is a pretty much steady composition of pioneer species as dominant element with non-pioneer light demanding and shade tolerant species in the understory. All the duration of 20 years. And then when we come to 60 years, there has been clear transition where the pioneer species, short living ones died. And then there was a transition to shade tolerant species, which then continues to all growth. So that's a classical principle of ecological succession. It's illustrated also with pairwise break-retis similarity indices. The break-retis is a quantitative similarity, so it responds also to abundance of species, not only to species lists. And we can see that there is a block of high similarities between 5, 12, and 20 years succession. This similarity on the diagonal, that's between replicated plots of the same stage. So you see that there is no difference between the same stage similarities and those for other early succession. But then there is a transition to low similarity with 60 years and even lower for old growth. When we look at other parameters of this example, then species richness increasing and then at 60 years getting on the level of primary forest, functional richness even higher than the old growth. But when we look at the carbon storage, then 60 years is nowhere close to primary forest, mostly because of big trees. The orange color is trees with over 60 centimeters in diameter, and that's only typical for primary forest. This notion of secondary forest being valuable even for forest services and species diversity is getting some kind of traction. It's widespread and it's true to some extent, but we should not get overexcited about it. This is another such study showing that even after 20 years, the individual secondary forests in South America are getting a fairly high percentage of diversity of the nearby primary forests, but at the same time, this is not on the same level of diversity. We can count species in local communities, but because this is a secondary forest, then the differences between individual locations will be lower than in primary forest. So that means the beta diversity will be small, and so the regional diversity will still be much lower in secondary forests than in primary forests. And also the species composition is recovering very slowly. In this study, it will take centuries, because even after 50 years, although the species diversity has recovered, then the composition, there were only very, very partial recovery of species composition. And after 20 years, only 34% of species composition recovered, which is much less than the diversity. So secondary forests can be diverse, but it's a different diversity from primary forests. They can't replace species level conservation of the primary forests. Okay, we have also mentioned before that the primary forest species are better protected from herbivores than pioneer plants. This is illustrated here. This is a typical pioneer species, and you can see leaves full of holes. This is because the principal enemies of this macaranga tree in early succession are other plants. And for that macaranga, it's important to have maximum growth rate, reaching height as far as possible, so that it can overshadow competing plants. And whether it's done with perfect leaves or with leaves full of holes is less important. The fact that the defense against herbivores is expensive is shown here on another early successional species, on Cecropia, where individual plants can have different investment into tannins, which is a defensive compound in leaves against herbivores. And so This is a relationship between the tannin concentration on individual plants and how fast they grow, how fast they produce new leaves. And you can see that there is a significant cost of defense against herbivores. However, there is an interesting exception. The early successional plants often have mutualisms with ants, which serve as protection against herbivores as well as climbers and lianas. And there is an interesting situation of convergent evolution on three continents using different species towards the same principle. We have Cecropia plants, which have hollow stems serving as housing places for specialized Azteca ants, which are protecting the plant. They are very aggressive, but they are also fed by the plant. These are so-called Millerian bodies, which are produced by plant and eaten by ants. Completely evolutionary unrelated case is with endospermum trees in New Guinea, which again have hollow stems and providing nesting for Camponotus ants, again protecting plants, but also being fed with extra floral nectaries at the base of the petiole of the leaves. And again, Macaranga plants in Southeast Asia, they are providing housing opportunities under the stipules and again feeding ants with the food bodies. And this is the Southeast Asian situation. Now, when we look at some herbivores, which are actually feeding on either primary or secondary forest plants, we are going back to our example of 1 hectare primary and 1 hectare secondary forest in lowland New Guinea. These are all the trees above 5 centimeter DBH mapped there and sampled from mining herbivores. Miners are very specialized type of herbivores where the larvae are tunneling inside of the leaf and feeding as they go. So this is an example of a larva starting when it's small, when it emerges from an egg. And then as it grows, then you see the tunnel is getting wider and wider. Finally, it completes development, pupates, and the very small species of Lepidoptera can emerge. There are some examples here. It can also be fly, it can also be a wasp or beetle. The mining lifestyle is phylogenetically very flexible, so lots of herbivorous lineages have species which chose it. And when we look at individual trees here, then both in primary and secondary forest, there are between 0 and 5 species of miners feeding on every individual tree. And when you see visually the shades of colors, there is no difference between primary and secondary forest. So again, we can see that on the level of individual trees, the species diversity of mining herbivores is recovered in secondary forest. However, the picture is completely different when we look at the whole 1 hectare. This is the species accumulation. As we increase the number of trees which we accumulate, then the number of minor species across these trees is increasing much faster for primary forest. Simply there is a bigger diversity of tree species, and because miners are specialized, then there is also bigger cumulative diversity of corresponding minor species. And so when we finish with 1 hectare, we end up with 3 times almost a higher diversity of miners in primary than in secondary forest. So again, we can't overestimate secondary forest in terms of their value for biodiversity. Now, this is an example of food webs in the forest succession in New Guinea at high altitude forest, 1700 meters, where we have 0.2 hectares plots with early successional vegetation, late secondary and primary forest. So you can see some cell thinning between early and late secondary forest. And then these are so-called bipartite food webs, where at the base are individual plant species with color showing the genus and the size of the block, the biomass of the plant. And the top row is individual species of caterpillars feeding on these plants. The connections show the intensity of trophic interactions, basically which caterpillar feeds on which host. These complicated food webs can be summarized in a number of different ways, but when we look at host specialization, then we see that the number of specialist and generalist caterpillars is not showing any trend during the succession. This is actually somewhat surprising because we know from much better studied temperate zone successions that there is actually a trend from generalist herbivores in pioneer vegetation to more specialized ones in the primary forests. The reason for that is that in the temperate zone, insects have a limited number of generations a year, typically one or two, and the early successional stages are composed mostly from very short living plants, typically annual species. So you have difficulties for herbivorous insects to find early pioneer stages because they occur unpredictably in response to unpredictable disturbance and colonize them quickly before they disappear because they often only last for 1 year or a few years. And so it's a good idea for these herbivores to be generalists so they are not dependent on one or few plant species to find in these unpredictable early successions. In the tropics, it looks like this doesn't work that way. First, insects have 5 to 6 generations a year, so they are much more flexible. And second, as we have seen, the early succession is dominated by pioneers, trees and shrubs. We are saying that they are short-living, but that's relative for trees. So that still means, let's say, 20 years. And so insects can have about 100 generations on that vegetation. So that's pretty permanent resource where the selection for generalist host range is no longer working. And that's why we don't have this trend in specialization for tropical herbivores. This is how such study happens in the field, sampling from a secondary forest and makeshift laboratory where the herbivorous larvae are reared and tested for host range of plants and identified. So we can ask, can we have actually tropical succession starting the temperate zone style with an annual herbaceous plants which can disappear very quickly? Yes, it can happen in some cases. These are very early successional stages from the same location in mountain New Guinea, where you can see pretty much monospecific growth of bidens plants, which only last for 1 year, then disappears. And in another case of secondary succession, there is an Asteraceae plant again, which is a very transitory stage. So these are not very common, but these early stages can happen even in the tropics. And then you would expect that insect might have difficulties finding them, although they still have the advantage of higher number of generations a year than in the temperate zone. Another important taxon on successional vegetation in the tropics are ants, where we can see again, and this is going to the 1 hectare of primary and secondary lowland forest in New Guinea, we can see higher diversity of ant species in primary than secondary forest, and certain overlap in species composition between them. However, when we look at the abundance of ants, then the secondary forests are much more hosting much more abundant ants, which has consequences for predation rate. Ants are important predators, and we can measure that predation using dummy caterpillars made of plasticine, which are exposed on vegetation. And if predators attack them, they will leave their marks. So we can see whether it was a bird after with beak marks, or whether there were prints of mandibles of ants. Looking at this kind of comparison, we see that secondary predation rate by ants on these caterpillars is much higher than in the primary forest, but it's not the same for birds and parasitoids, where the differences are not significant. So secondary forests are more dangerous for insect herbivores than primary forests, and it's mostly because of higher activity by ants. Okay, and now we are going to something completely different in ecological succession, and that is the trajectories the succession can take. So far, we have been mostly talking about straightforward direction with pioneer species of trees to later succession and to primary forest. However, there can be also diversion of succession to alternative trajectories or even block stages. So this is an example from Barro, Colorado, where about 8% of canopy gaps are not orderly developing to the pioneer trees and the primary vegetation, but they take detour of different duration, either through palm stage dominated by palms or dominated by lianas. Lianas can actually block succession in a tree gap. These are examples from Panama, where there is really a complete colonization of the space by lianas, or from Peru, where there is a cover of climbers, which again blocks progress of secondary vegetation. Another option shown here in the mountain forest in Vietnam is with climbing bamboo, where you can see how the canopy gap is being closed from the sides, where bamboo is sending very fast growing shoots, and they can basically close the gap from the top, so that you basically create a carpet of bamboo, which will stop any progression by the seedlings and saplings of pioneer trees trying to grow as fast as they can. The lianas and climbers can play a generally important role in early succession, especially in some habitats. For instance, the riverine habitat, which is often disturbed by floods, is typical as having these carpets of climbers all over the vegetation. Generally, lianas can colonize vegetation quickly, but then it takes a long time before they grow and reach a higher level of biomass. This is an example of 42 successional trajectories in Panama, where we are looking at the biomass ratio between lianas and trees. So already after 5 years, we have a large range of relationships where lianas can be up to 15% of biomass, but then it takes time to keep increasing this share over the secondary succession. This is another example from 30 lowland sites in Costa Rica, where we can compare trends in secondary succession and the primary forest for trees and lianas. So when we look at density, stem density, then the liana stem density is high at early successional stages, and then is declining as lots of small lianas are replaced by fewer large ones. When we look at liana species diversity, that remains steady throughout the succession, unlike with trees, which where the diversity is increasing. And when we look at the liana biomass, then similarly as with trees, is increasing during the succession. Now we will have a look at a different successional series, and that is along the big rivers. This is actually often very nice chronosequence with young stages of succession close to the river, and as you progress further away, you get older and older successions. Why is that? Because a river has occasional floods, as we have seen. Very heavy tropical rainfall can cause floods of different intensity, which can disturb and wash away vegetation at different distances from the river. So very rare big floods will cause will restart succession further away from the river, but only very rarely. And so on average, the successional stages there will be older than those closer to the river. So this is an example where from Peruvian Amazon, where we have a very early stages close to the river, then we have Cecropia, early succession, and then we progress towards much older stages. Okay, now we will talk a little bit about the succession on fallow fields, abundant fields of slash and burn agriculture. That is a very common practice in lots of tropical areas where the either primary or secondary forest is cut down in areas from a few hundred square meters to 1 or 2 hectares. And then the vegetation, the cut down vegetation, once it dries, is burned down, which means that the soil is fertilized by this ash and then used for either one or more likely mixed crops, which can be grown there for 2 or 3 years, and then when the soil is exhausted again, the whole field is abandoned. And as long as this disturbance is not frequent enough, and as long as the general landscape matrix still includes forests, then the site can be recolonized and undergo classical secondary succession, which is not very different from the three gap succession. This is an example from New Guinea where the slash and burn farmers prefer to cut down primary forest because it's a bigger volume of vegetation. So when they burn it, it's better fertilization and soil is less exhausted, and so they get much bigger crops, much bigger yields. Although cutting down primary forest is much more labor intense and also more dangerous than secondary forest. So it's much more work, but also higher productivity. This is a secondary forest cut down, and you can already see that some of the trees were burned. So you can see patches of ash here. Then this is taro grown there, and finally, this will be abandoned and left for secondary succession. This is a freshly abandoned garden, so that gives an idea about the size. And this is in primary forest at higher elevation, so in New Guinea again. So this will be progressing very similarly as a tree gap, as a larger tree gap succession. You can also see that at low population sizes, this really mimics the tree gap dynamics. This is a small hamlet with some gardens around in the matrix of primary forest. But of course, in lots of areas, the situation is completely different, and there is a much higher pressure on repeated cycles of slash and burn agriculture. This is still quite a low density countryside where you can see that there are some active gardens with growing food that's in this area. And then the neighborhood, there are secondary forests recovering from previous food gardens that's here. And then there is a matrix of primary forest. This is highlands of New Guinea. Much more intense agricultural landscape where there are some slash and burn fields, there are some more permanent plots for agriculture, and then also there are some planted trees and some remnants of the forest. So this is a landscape which, when you look at it from distance, so that you don't recognize individual tree species, that actually looks sort of temperate zone style. For instance, when you compare it with highlands in the Czech Republic and elsewhere in Europe, you know, there is a very similar structure of the landscape. So you can say that there is a convergence in how people shape the landscape. Of course, it's possible to say that New Guinea used to be a European colony by Germany and Great Britain, and so maybe this is just legacy of the colonial system. It's not like that. Actually, the agriculture in the highlands of New Guinea was invented independently from elsewhere, so it's an 8,000 years old tradition, and it's also one of the areas which was the last to be contacted by outside world. It was only 1930s, so that's the last, the very last big first contact between civilizations. And when it happened, there is a photographic documentation of the very first contact, and you can see that the landscape is pretty much the same as we see it now. So this was shaped by stone tools, because during that first contact, that was the most advanced technology. And so the landscape shaped by stone tools looks pretty much the same as the current European landscape. And that's what we like, probably going back psychologically to very deep layers of when we were surviving in African savanna before going out of Africa. And that maybe reminds us of that ancient ecosystem. Now, when we go back to the slash and burn, this is the nitrate and potassium concentration in the water which is flowing out of that garden area. You can see that, again, compared with the nearby forest, and you can see that there is a big spike of the concentration after cutting down and burning down the vegetation. But then it gets washed away and exhausted by crops in a matter of 2 or 3 years. And that's why the slash and burn agriculture is also called shifting agriculture. That's why the farmers have to keep changing the location of unless they use industrial fertilizers, which of course they don't. So this need to move often leads to much more intense practices where the fallow, the period which is where the vegetation is left to recover is very short, and that has negative consequences on the trajectory of succession. So this is an example from Thailand where the short fallowing is leading to either bamboo climax, not really climax, but bamboo stage, or chromolena, herbaceous plant stage, or if there is a very intense repeated clearing or burning, then finally we have imperata cylindrica, the grassland, which will take over the place, and it can be a blocked succession stage there. Likewise, this is from Malaysia. Again, after shifting agriculture, if there is no further disturbance, we progress orderly into young secondary forest, old secondary, and then the lowland dipterocarp forest. But with repeated grazing and cutting, we will finally get to grassland stage with a number of grasses. With burning, we will get imperata, because that's a typical stage where the succession can be blocked. That imperata, it's a very tall grass. It creates a lot of flammable material, and if it's burned repeatedly once every few years, then it can be actually a blocked successional stage forever there, because that grass recovers very nicely and regenerates after the fire, unlike any possible seedlings on saplings of trees, which will be killed by fire. This is the last example of different trajectories based on the type of disturbance in the neotropics, where if we have abundant pastures, then because pastures result in a different types of disturbance, including fertilization by cattle, then it goes to Wismia, pioneer tree, while if we leave the shifting agriculture for recovery without pastures, then it will go to typical Cecropia stage. So even visually, we have early successional forests, but of two very different types. This is an illustration of what I already said about Imperata grasslands. Again, this is deforested area from New Guinea, which burns during the dry season every 2 or 3 years, and therefore we can, you know, this can be hundreds of years of block succession, which actually is very it's very unfavorable type of landscape. It has very low species diversity, and economically it's also unproductive. It's not good for food production or for pastures or any other use. But as long as it burns, like you see here, the whole range basically caught fire, then it will be blocked successional stage potentially forever. Now, with the secondary succession, we also have the secondary vegetation open to invasive species. One of the very few rules in ecology which actually work very reliably is that in primary tropical forests they are not open to alien plant species. They are very resistant to alien invasions, but not the secondary vegetation, which can be vulnerable. This is example from lowland Papua New Guinea forests, where you are looking at forests after slash and burn agriculture, which can have up to 30% of biomass due to invasive species, especially two of them, Bignoniaceae spathodea campanulata, a pioneer species from Africa, or Piper aduncum, again a pioneer species from tropical America. This is a study on distribution of Piper aduncum in the lowlands, and the succession following gardens is actually invaded a lot together with landslides. But not primary forest, which where again Piper aduncum is not entering that ecosystem. We can sort of wonder or speculate why even New Guinea secondary vegetation is so vulnerable to alien species, because it's it has a very rich assortment of pioneer species, including 91 species of mostly pioneer Makaranga genus. So there always have to be some kind of opening, some kind of advantage which that alien species has. Piper aduncum is proving to be extremely successful, and it looks like it's because although pretty much all pioneer species flower and fruit very early, then Piper aduncum can do it still faster than its competitors. So if there is a repeated disturbance, vegetation cut after 2 or 3 years, that's enough for Piper aduncum to already generate seeds and increase the seed supply in the soil seed bank, unlike the competing native species. This is 1600 meters elevation. That's the landscape which was deforested for slash and burn agriculture and then left to regenerate. And you can see it's being taken over by this single alien species, Piper aduncum. Again, when we color its current spread, we can see that it's really taking over the whole vegetation. There is a discussion or slight controversy about how alien plant species can be harmful to the ecosystem in terms of especially causing species impoverishment of the native species and local extinctions. We definitely know this can be a big problem with animal invasions, where invasive plants or invasive species of animals can cause a lot of extinction, you know, predators of their prey and so on. But it's more controversial with plants, where some botanists will claim that this kind of native plants driven to extinction by aliens is actually rare. My colleagues Kenneth Mollem and Jan Lepsch did experiment with exclusion of Piper aduncum in secondary succession over 5 years. So they ended up in the lowland New Guinea with this control experiment, which is sort of decent secondary forest after 5 years, and the one where the aduncum was removed. So this is completely native vegetation, and surprisingly, there was a lot of variability between replicated plots, both control and removal ones, but there was no effect of excluding aduncum on the number of local species, where in that 15 times 15 meter gardens, there were about 48 species on average of secondary native plants, and that didn't really change whether aduncum was there or not. Although the biomass of native plants increased once aduncum was excluded, clearly at the expense of what normally would be aduncum there. I said that the law about primary forest being resistant to alien species holds generally. It's true with exception of oceanic islands, which have limited native species pool, and that's the only place where even primary forests are vulnerable. This is example from Mauritius, where the study from 5 years ago selected the best preserved primary forest patches in conservation areas and surveyed them, and these five forest areas all were actually dominated by alien species, especially in 4 cases out of 5 by Psidium cattleyanum, invasive shrub, and then by 2 others, Cinnamomum verum and Syzygium jambos, in the 5th place. So unfortunately, the oceanic islands are vulnerable even for their primary forests. Okay, and that's the end of the whole forest succession chapter, where we are finishing with a recently set up experiment at the New Guinea Highlands, where this is the succession after slash and burn agriculture, where we will be looking at the effect of Piper aduncum again, and also the grasses on the succession. So with these plots, we will be, some of them will have Piper aduncum excluded, some of them will have Piper aduncum and grasses excluded, and there will be a treatment with insecticide of all these options, as well as control. So we will be looking at how the insect herbivores combine in effect on succession with the effect of alien plants and grasses.